Thank you very much for this very kind introduction, and thank you everybody for being here. So, as Friedhelm just mentioned, the title is Predicting the Outcome of Strategic Behavior. It's a bit of a catchy title to somehow illustrate what I'm going to talk about. And in this area, I will focus on computational aspects and approximation algorithms. So first, I will start by saying something about game theory, solution concepts in this area, which I call equilibria, and I will discuss some problems that we have there and discuss some trade-offs. In particular, I will present two very well-known concepts. One is the concept of mixed mesh equilibrium, the other one, the concept of pure mesh equilibrium. And here we will focus basically on two topics. One is the existence of these solutions, and the other one is we talk about complexity. And then I will, after we discussed that a little bit, propose a third solution concept, which I call approximate equilibria. And again, we will see there what you can reach in terms of complexity and existence of the solution concept. Let me just start by giving you a very simple motivation on explanation on what we are doing. So what is actually strategic behavior? If you look it up in Wikipedia, you get something like that. So it says that game theory studies mathematical models of conflict and cooperation between intelligent, rational decision makers. And instead of describing it too theoretically, I want to go into a little example. And the example that it shows is selfish traffic routing, something that you probably know from everyday life. So this on the right-hand side, I hope you can see it. It's a picture of the traffic in the Ruhr area of, I think, yesterday in the afternoon. It was before the commuter traffic, so it's basically not too reddish. But as you can see, there are situations out there that we face every day in our life where the outcome of our decision depends on, well, what we decided, but also what other decided. So the question on how good am I performing on a road not only depends on the chosen route that, the decision that I chose, but also on the decisions of the others. And that is something that we want to study in game theory, So here in this example of traffic routing, we assume that each of these participants, each of these drivers, want to choose a route that minimizes their respective travel time. Of course, this decision depends, or the outcome depends, on the chosen routes by others. And instead of looking at such more or less complicated example, on the right-hand side, we start with a very, very simple example, which is two cars on two roads. I think it doesn't get much easier. So here, in this very, very simple example, we assume we have two drivers which want to go from S to T, from the source to the target, and they have two roads that they can choose from, the upper one and the lower one. And as I said before, each of these two drivers just wants to choose the road or the route that minimizes his travel time. And his travel time does not only depend on his choice, but also on the choice of the other guy. And here, this model, I choose that the upper road takes 60 minutes, regardless of how many cars are traveling on that road. And the lower road, the travel time depends on the number of users. So here I chose, in this very simple example, I chose it the following way. We take the number of cars and multiply it by 29 minutes, let's say, and that then gives us the total travel time for each of the participants on this road. So if one driver is on that road, it takes them 29 minutes. If there are two guys on that road, it takes them 58 minutes each. The question in such a situation now is, what's going to happen? Here, in this very simple example, it's very, very simple because we can argue that in every case, for the two players, taking the lower road is always faster because 58 is always less than 60, if I'm not mistaken. And we want to study situations like that, but of course in a bit more complicated general setting. The general setting, how we want to model that in a mathematical way, is called a strategic game. And basically, a strategic game consists of three components. One is a set of players. In our example, it was just these two players. In general, we talk about more than two players. And each of these players has some action or strategy, how we call it, that he can choose from. In our very simple example, it was just he can choose between these two options, these two roads. In general, it might be some set of what we call strategies, which we will denote by this S sub I. It could be different for each player. So S sub I is the set of strategies, actions, whatever, that each player I can choose from. And now, if every player chooses exactly one of his strategies, this gives us a vector of n strategies, and we call that a state, just to have something that we can talk about. Now, given such a state, we want to know how good is each player. And for that reason, our game has a cost function, one cost function for each player, which just maps from the set of states to some, let's say, real number, which is the cost of that player. So in our example, this cost function was somehow defined by this network and these numbers of 60 and 29 and 58. In general, it might be any kind of a function which just has property that it maps from the states to those real numbers. So this is how we want to model such situations in general. Now, in such a game, you want to know what's going to happen. You want to make some kind of prediction or want to explain what's going to happen in this game. To do that, of course, we need some assumptions on what the players want to do, how they behave, and how the game is being played. And here we assume, this is very important, that this game is only being played once. So there's no repetition, you cannot do something in between, it's only being played once. Also very important is that we have to assume, that the players actually know what game they are playing. So they have full information about the game, they have full information about the other players, about their strategies, about their payoffs. They know everything. And thirdly, we assume the players behave rational and selfish, and that they want to seek to minimize their cost, which is some strong assumption if you look into reality, but we have to make some assumption on the behavior, and this is one that is complex enough for us. In particular, what it rules out is that people behave in some way social. So they do not cooperate to, be nice to each other or something like that. The only thing that they're interested in is their cost. Okay. And then what we want to know is what's going to happen, and we describe that by what we call an equilibrium, an outcome. And in equilibrium, we say that no player would choose a suboptimal strategy. And this is due to the assumption that they are rational and they want to minimize their costs. So it's, I think, plausible to assume that in the end, it would be unreasonable for any player to choose a suboptimal strategy. What does it mean? So it means that each player optimizes his cost function, and it means he chooses a strategy that minimizes his cost, of course, given the strategies of the others. In other words, such an equilibrium is some state in which no player could improve by switching or changing to another strategy. And this is what we are looking for. And in the previous example, it was definitely the case, because we could argue that 58 minutes is always less than 60. In general, it might be a bit more complicated. So why are we interested in such problems? Well, first of all, I think there are many examples where we can actually see strategic behavior. If they think about what's happening in markets, if players want to buy something or want to sell something, if they can set prices, this is definitely something where we see strategic behavior. People want to minimize their costs, maximize their profits. This is something where we see it. Similarly, in auctions, you always want to pay as little as you can or earn as much as you want. There you always might also have strategic behavior. And in an increasing manner, we see strategic problems and resource allocation problems. Car traffic is one very obvious example. We have some resource, which is our streets, the scarce resource, and we have strategic decisions. We want to go from some place to some other place as fast as we can. But there are also others. If you talk about computer networks, we have bandwidth allocation problems, tasks being scheduled on servers. Of course, if you want to have a task, want to process it somewhere on some server, you might have an incentive to choose a server which is faster than the other one. You have peer-to-peer systems where you have incentive issues, car traffic I mentioned, and so on. So there are many resource allocation problems where you have incentive issues, where people act strategically to get some advantage. And why are we interested in these kind of equilibria and these kinds of solutions? Well, first of all, if you want to predict the behavior in such systems, you have to be able to make some prediction. You might ask, why do I want to have this prediction? Well, if you participate in the system, you want to decide what is your best strategy or what should I do, which route to work should I take, you should be able to somehow predict what's going to happen to be able to decide what you want to do. And thirdly, if you are a system designer or as a system somehow belongs to you or you're part of that system or you're administrator, whatever, computing equilibrium might tell you how should you modify or build your system or how shouldn't you do that. Because sometimes you might actually make mistakes by building these systems. And actually I do have an example on the next slide where this becomes very evident. Again, let's talk about traffic, and again, a bit more complicated, but still we have two players. We have two players, again, going from S to T in this very simple network. And this time I denoted by X the number of cars. So if two cars are on that road, it takes them 2 times 29 minutes. We can, of course, again, formulate the whole thing as a strategic game. Just as an exercise, let's see how that works. Set of players now would be two players. Let's call them one and two. The strategies, well, I call the one upper and the other one lower strategy. So each player has these two strategies in his set of allowed strategies. And then we would have some cost function, which would be something like that. So if both take the upper path, the cost of player one would be 118, if we did the calculation right. If they choose different paths, the cost of the first one would be 89, and so on. So I didn't write down all the numbers. And the equilibrium in this case obviously would be, well, one player would choose the upper path and the other one the lower path, and both would have travel time of 89 minutes. Yeah. So this would be an equilibrium. This is very obvious. So let's assume we want to build a fast road in this network. Let's assume we think it might be a good idea to connect this node with that node with some road which only takes 1 minute to traverse. Could be a good idea, you think, but if you now calculate the new equilibrium, it turns out that the only equilibrium that is left here is for both players to take this zigzag path, and then the total travel time for each of them suddenly increases to 117 minutes. So why is this going to happen? Well, let's just see as an exercise why this is the only equilibrium. In the network before, both players choosing different routes, so the one upper, the other one the lower, was the only equilibrium. Now in this new network, what happens now? Let's look at the one at the upper path. He travels 89 minutes. If he now would switch to this zigzag path, he would have 29 minutes here, 1 minute here, and this would be 58 minutes, so it's becoming cheaper. So the old equilibrium is no longer an equilibrium. And similarly for the lower one, he can just argue that instead of taking this path, it's always cheaper to take this zigzag path. Reason is, this takes 60 minutes, this one is always cheaper. So you can see that by building a new road, which seems to be a good idea, the equilibrium suddenly becomes worse. And that is a reason why you should, before constructing such a road, for example, probably should just compute the new equilibrium and see if it actually helps or makes things worse. Okay. So let's look again at this solution concept that I proposed. In the literature, it's known as pure Nash equilibrium, which just says that no player chooses an optimal strategy. In particular, we say that each player chooses exactly one strategy. That's how I defined that. Let's discuss some properties of this concept. One problem that we might have is that it relies on certain assumptions, like, for example, rationality, and that players do not cooperate, and that they have full cooperation, full information. This is certainly a problem. I mean, if you look into the real world, players usually do not have full information, and they certainly do not act rational. Look at our streets, it's not rational what's happening there. There's a whole bunch of literature out there in economics and game theory which deals with bounded rationality and limited information. I'm not going to discuss more of that, but there are people talking about that. But of course, models and results become a lot more complicated. So we stick to that assumption for now. Second problem that we have is, in the examples that we just showed, there was always one equilibrium. In general, there might be more than one, which is kind of problematic. In particular, if we say that this equilibrium is some kind of a prediction of what's going to happen. But what is a prediction if we say either that or this happens? It's not really, might not be really useful. Which one of these equilibria is actually going to be played? And if we agree on one, if you say this one should be the one that the players play, how do the player actually coordinate on playing that, if they do? There's a whole bunch of literature out there which talks about equilibrium selection, which argues which of the equilibria should be played and will be played. And again, I will say, I'm not going to discuss that here. We will just stick to the model that we are satisfied with just having some equilibrium. Third problem is much more difficult, namely that we might not have such an equilibrium at all. There are games out there where no pure Nash equilibrium, where every player chooses exactly one strategy, exists. And that is really a problem. I mean, we want to have a prediction, but we cannot say that there always is one. And here's an example where we do not have such an equilibrium. It's a well-known game of rock, paper, scissors. I guess you know that. You can also write this down as a strategic game with two players. The strategy of each player would be rock, paper, or scissor, one of these actions. And the cost function is the obvious one. If you lose, you have to pay one. If you win, you have cost of minus one. If there's a draw, you get zero. And it's obvious that in every case, there's at least one player who can improve his cost by switching to some other strategy. There's no stable strategy in that sense. There's always one player who could choose a better option. That's not really good. It's really a problem if we want to have some kind of prediction. But luckily, there's a way out of that. And this is actually the original concept of Nash equilibrium proposed by John Nash, the guy over here. And he said, it was a very clever idea, he said, well, what happens if we assume that instead of choosing one single strategy, each player actually chooses a probability distribution over his set of strategies? So we allow the players to randomize. And then he said, okay, what's the aim of the player? We said, okay, it's the obvious thing. Player want to minimize the expected cost. So each player just chooses a probability distribution. We then can just have a probability distribution over the set of states, and then we can have expected cost, and each player wants to minimize his expected cost. A very simple, very clever idea. And he actually could show in his PhD thesis in the 50s that such an equilibrium always exists. So this PhD thesis, by the way, was only like 21 or 25 pages and got him a Nobel Prize in the 80s, no, 90s. So he showed that such an equilibrium always exists, and if you think about our rock, paper, scissors example that we just had, here the equilibrium would, for example, be each player chooses each strategy with probability 1/3, which is somehow what you would do intuitively in some repeated game. You would just choose kind of at random each step with the same probability. Problem here is that in some cases, randomization might not always be realistic or desired. In particular, it's not really clear what is the outcome of such a game if you have a probability distribution over different states. It's not, usually you want to have some one prediction, not the probability distribution. So it might not be desired. And additionally, he assumes that player minimize expected cost. This means they are risk neutral. And this is also an assumption which can be questioned. There are definitely scenarios out there where people are risk seeking or risk avoiding. Being risk neutral is sometimes a strong assumption. For that reason, we want to focus on pure equilibria a bit more today. But let me say something else about mixed equilibrium, and let's now start talking about algorithmic aspects. So far, all that I told you was already known for centuries and was basically the domain of game theory and mathematics. But at the beginning of the 90s, when the internet era started, computer scientists became more and more interested in algorithmic problems in game theory. For one reason was that we had more and more strategic interactions within the internet, so kind of games were played there, at least strategic games were played there in the 90s. And on the other hand, we now have the increasing ability of actually measuring what people are doing. For example, on roads, we have all these navigational systems, and you can actually measure where people are going. So it became more and more interesting to actually compute things or predict things. And what I did, as what computer scientists, at least theorists, often do, is ask complexity questions. And one was to ask, well, this mixed Nash equilibrium concept of John Nash is really great. How hard is it actually to compute such a thing? What's the complexity of computing such a mixed Nash equilibrium? And there was a series of papers starting in 2004-05, and they showed that computing such an equilibrium is hard for some complexity class which is called PPAD, and that is even true for games which have two players. I'm not going to explain what PPAD actually means. Let's say just in a very colloquial manner that if we have a two-player game with, say, N strategies, then the best known algorithms that we have might need exponential time, so 2 to the n steps to find such an equilibrium. This is a very hand-waving colloquial description of what PPAD hard means. So we do not have any efficient algorithm to compute such an equilibrium, and if we had one, it would be a bit surprising. So it's a bit like in this NP world, where we also do not know whether there are polynomial time algorithms for NP hard problems. Similarly here, but not as bad. So if you would have an efficient algorithm for such problems, it wouldn't just be as devastating as having one for NP hard problems, but still it would be very surprising for us. That's enough about this complexity issue. So why is this an important or important result? What's the consequences of that? Well, first of all, obviously, if you want to compute such an equilibrium, you might run into problems in terms of computational power. Practitioners would argue, well, we don't care, we solve NP-hard problems all the time. That might be true, but nonetheless, it still tells us it might be a computational difficult problem. But secondly, what I find much more important is a conceptual issue. The theorem of John Nash tells us that there is always a mixed Nash equilibrium, which is nice. But this theorem tells us, okay, there might always be one, but we cannot compute it. And then if we cannot compute it, how should the players who we predict they are going to play that, how should they actually compute it? I mean, how can they play an equilibrium if they cannot compute it? So it raises some doubt on whether this is a credible equilibrium concept. And this is, I think, the more important reason why we should study complexity issues in equilibrium. Okay, now let's go back to the concept of pure equilibrium, so we forget about all this randomization stuff. We have the much simpler version where every player only chooses exactly one strategy. I just argued and showed you an example of a game where there is no such pure Nash equilibrium. But on the other hand, there is a rich class of games, there are many classes, and one rich class in particular, where we have the guaranteed existence of such a pure equilibrium. Let's look at such a class, and one famous class is this class of so-called congestion games, which is a nice model for resource allocation problems. It basically models situations like our traffic routing example over there. And the key issue here is that the cost of a player is somehow defined over the uses or the allocation of resources. And the important thing is that the cost only depends on the number of other players using the same kind of resource that I use. Only on the number, not on their identity. And then you always have the guaranteed existence of an equilibrium, a pure equilibrium here. Again, we have bad news from the complexity side because it was shown that it's actually PLS hard to compute a pure equilibrium. PLS, again, same story as before, complexity class which captures hard problems and it would be surprising to find an efficient algorithm here. We don't know exactly. So it's again bad news and we only have for some very restricted special cases polynomial time algorithms, which is certainly a problem here. And what's also a problem is that this class of congestion games is a nice model of resource allocation, but it doesn't capture all the things that we might want to model. So in particular, if we, for example, assume that these players somehow that allocate some resource somehow have different influence on the performance of that resource, like for example they have different weights or sizes or whatever. This is no longer in this model of congestion games, and actually this destroys the property of the guaranteed existence of a pure equilibrium. Okay, so problems everywhere, everything is not as nice as it could be. Well, that makes it just more challenging. But let's just look back what I just told you so far. So even if we assume that we have players which act rational and have full information, we have this nice model, but still we have some problems. So we have existence issues, uniqueness issues. We might need some necessary additional assumption like this randomization, and algorithmic game theory just threw in another problem, which is the complexity problem. So just to see what where we are standing here, mixed match equilibrium is a very nice concept. It always exists. We need this randomization, which is a slight minus, I would say, and we have this big minus in terms of complexity. Pureness doesn't always exist. We do not need randomization, which I think is a nice property, but again, complexity is bad. And what I want to propose now in the second part of this presentation is a concept which is called approximate pure Nash. It also doesn't always exist, but it exists more often than the pure version. Again, we do not need randomization. Complexity is often better, I would say, but we need some certain additional assumptions. So somehow it's a relaxation of pure Nash with some nicer properties. And I would just like to explain what this concept is and where the advantages and disadvantages of that concept lie. So let's talk a bit about approximation. Usually in approximation, what we are looking for is, if you think about optimization, say, we're looking for a solution which is not as good as the optimal solution, but somehow close. Similarly here, you want to have something which is close to an equilibrium, and the most reasonable definition of that would be the following definition of an approximate equilibrium. You want to have a state where every player is a strategy which is nearly optimal given the choices of the others. So in particular, it means we call that an alpha approximate equilibrium. Think of alpha as something bit more than one. An alpha approximate equilibrium is a state where no player can decrease his cost by a factor of more than alpha. So if you set alpha to one, this is exactly the definition of pure Nash equilibrium. I would argue that if alpha is very close to one, slightly larger than one, it's pretty realistic. In particular, it's well motivated if you assume that players are somehow lazy, they are not very so sure about the information that they have, or there's some additional cost in changing strategies. So in particular, it means, well, it's like in everyday life. You're a bit lazy, you can choose between, I don't know, buy some car for, let's say, 20,000 euros or buy it for 100 euros less if you go to the next shop. Probably you would just buy it in the first shop. You don't care much about this very small relative change. But if the relative change is large, you would care a lot more, I guess. So I think this is a reasonable assumption, a reasonable concept, if alpha is small enough, close enough to one. Now, is it easier to find such an approximate equilibrium? Unfortunately, the answer is, in general, no. In a paper 2008, we showed that finding an alpha approximate equilibrium is, again, hard for this complexity class. For every polynomial time computable alpha, so even for very large alphas, it's still hard to find one. And even if you restrict your attention only to the class of these congestion games where you only have positive and increasing cost functions. So even in this restricted setting, even for very large alphas, it might be still very difficult to find such an approximate equilibrium. And people thought for quite some while, at least for a few years, that this concept now is dead and it doesn't make any sense to look at that concept anymore. But it turns out that if you look a bit closer into that proof, it uses some particular cost function which have some strange properties. To explain that, we should look a bit closer into the model of congestion games. Here's actually an example of such a congestion game. How is such a game defined? So in this class, we have, again, a strategic game, which has a set of players. But additionally, we have a set of resources. Think of these edges as being resources. And the strategy of a player is being defined as a set of these resources. So the set of allowed strategies is a collection of these sets of resources. In this example, the set of strategies for one player would be one set containing these three resources, another set containing these two, and a third set containing these two, for example. So this is how these sets are defined, the strategies are defined. Additionally, the costs are defined over these resources. That means that each of these resources has a cost function which maps the number of users to some, let's say, real number, which is the cost value. And the cost of a player now, if he chooses some strategy, is the following. We sum up over the resources in that strategy and sum up the cost of that resource, these resources. And the cost of these resources, of course, depend on the number of other users choosing this resource, just like in this example over here. Now, the proof that I mentioned earlier of PLS hardness or finding approximate equilibrium here uses strange cost function in the following sense. The cost function has the property that for one player, the value is very close to one, very close to zero, so very, very small. But for two players, it's a very, very high value. So if you would transform such a example into our network example, that would mean you have roads where you takes virtually no time to traverse if there's one car on that road, but it takes ages if there are two cars on that road. So it's a very particular crafted example that we used here in this reduction in that proof. And it turns out, that is a 2011 paper of us, that if you restrict your cost functions to be somewhat reasonable, you get a lot better results. In particular, if these cost functions are only linear, so of the form a times x plus b with positive coefficients, then there's an algorithm which computes a 2 plus epsilon approximate equilibrium. And even if you extend your class of allowed cost functions to be polynomial of some maximal degree d, you still can compute approximate equilibrium. But then the approximation factor goes up to d to the order of d. So this is certainly a significant improvement over the inapproximability result that we saw a few years earlier. And we only need what I would argue is some mild assumption on the structure of these delay functions. So they are a bit more realistic now. And I think we do not lose too much in expressive power. What I should note here is that we have this upper bound of 2 plus epsilon and d to the o to the d. We do not have any lower bound in that case. So it's totally unknown whether you could do something like, let's say, 1 plus epsilon in the linear case. It's absolutely not known. So it's very possible that this could be improved much, much further. Another thing that I want to note is, this 2 plus epsilon, is it actually good? Who would play a 2 plus epsilon approximate equilibrium? I guess no one, at least not in practice. Because what does it mean? It means that there is a player, or there might be a player, who can prove his payoff by a factor of 2. Well, he could decrease his cost by a factor of 2. And I don't know, if you would buy a car for, let's say, you go into a shop and they tell you, you can buy that car for 20,000 euros, you can buy the same car for 10. Well, I guess you wouldn't stick to the one with 20. You would certainly switch your strategy choice to get the one for 10. And so this is, for practical purposes, still way too high, this 2 plus epsilon. But at least it's some significant improvement over what we saw a few years earlier. And it leaves some hope that it might be improved by other techniques. But motivated by that question, we ask ourselves, as joint work with Martin Geiring, what happens if you look at special classes of games? Can we improve somehow this factor? And what we did is we looked at games with a fixed class of delay functions, or cost functions. And we could state the following theorem. So we have a polynomial time algorithm which computes 1 plus epsilon times psi of f approximate equilibrium in games where the class of cost function is from this set f. And this psi of f is this simple expression, which I have no idea how to evaluate except for numerical methods. But if you plug in some functions in here and see what happens, you get something like that. So if the function, set of function only contains that state of function x plus 1, you get for this psi a 1.5. And if the offset increases here, you get something which is decreasing. So if you take the log x, for example, you get 1.83. Quadratic is 6, cubic is 20, so this is very, very large. What it tells you is that if you have a game, well, let's say you have linear functions which, you have linear functions with relatively high offsets, like say at least 3, then you can compute a very close to 1.25 approximate equilibrium. So offset helps, and a small slope also seems to help, which you can see here in the log example. So if you have games which have Mayer's cost functions, then the algorithm gives you a reasonably, at least a better approximation than 2, and you might actually get close to 1. So the bottom line of these two last slides is that this concept of approximate pure equilibrium can give you polynomial time computability of an equilibrium concept, which is realistic enough if you have nice cost functions in some way. But of course, there are still improvements possible. So that was about computing these approximate things. And I also said that it helps us in terms of existence. Let's look at the following example, which is weighted congestion games. Recall our definition of congestion games. So I said that in these congestion games, we have players, we have resources, and the players choose these resources, and the costs then depend on the number of players using a resource. As I argued before, in many applications, this is too simple. Often enough, you have resources where somehow your cost depends on certain properties of users. One simple property would be some sort of size. If you think about job scheduling or, I don't know, routing, data volume, this is certainly a property which influences the congestion or the performance of a resource. It would be nice to somehow put that into our model, and this is captured by the model of weighted congestion games. The only difference in terms of difference between congestion games and weighted congestion games is now that players have a weight, each player has a weight, and the cost now is different. The cost just is, instead of mapping just the number of users to a cost value, we map the sum of the user's weight to a cost value. Natural thing to do. Problem is that if you extend that class with this property, you no longer have the existence of pure equilibria guaranteed. And I just want to show you an example where that actually happens. Again, I have a network game. This time it's undirected. Assume we have two players. Player one has weight one, player two has weight two. Very simple. Player one wants to go from left to right, so either he chooses these two edges or these two. And player one wants to go from top to bottom, so either he chooses these two or these two edges. Okay? Now, if you just calculate the costs that happens, we get the following table. Let me explain what's happening. So if you assume the strategy at the state where the first player chooses the upper two edges and the other one the two left ones, then the cost for the first guy would be, well, here are both on this edge, those 2 times 3 to the power of 2 plus 9 times 1, which is 27. And player 2, he has to pay for these two edges, so it's again the cost value here, 2 times 3 to the power of 2, plus 9 times 2, which is 36, and so on. So if you get all these numbers, and it turns out that none of these states is a pure equilibrium, because there's always one that can improve. So here, for example, the player 2 could change from left to right, which would improve his payoff. His cost from 36 to 35. And again, this is not an equilibrium because that guy could change from 29 to 37 and so on. As you can see, there's always one who could change and improve his cost. But what you also see here in at least this example, the change is relatively small compared to the cost that they actually have. So here the player 2 only has change of improvement of 1 and the other one only improvement of 2. So the improvement relatively to the cost that they have is, seems to be pretty small. And actually, we could prove this joint work with Hans Knecht and Klim from Berlin. We could prove that this is always the case. Or conversely, we could prove that there are always approximate equilibria with small approximation factors. So that means, so what we proved is that if we look at these basic congestion games with only two players, like in the example that we just had, we can show that there are approximate equilibria with the following approximation factors depending on what kind of cost functions we have. If you have at most quadratic delay functions, cost functions, you get 1.054 as approximate equilibrium. So that means, like in the example I just showed you, it's like a 5% approximation of an equilibrium, which is, I think, pretty good. And as the degree of the polynomial rises, it only slightly rises this approximation factor. For the whole set of concave functions, we get 1.5. These are very nice small numbers, and we actually have, yeah, this, but this is only for two players. We also did this for an arbitrary number of players, and there it gets a bit more complicated. This factor rises drastically. So for polynomials of degree 2, we get at least something which is smaller than 2, but it's still 4 over 3. And as the degree of polynomial rises, we get even larger numbers. We have a very loose bound for general degree of d, which is d plus 1, which is very loose. For concave functions, we stay to this 1.5. What I want to note here is that if you look at lower bounds, so if you look at examples which actually achieve a very bad approximation factor, we only get these bounds. So we have kind of tight bounds for two players. So all examples that we have actually look like the example that I just showed you on the slide before, and they achieve roughly these numbers. But we do not have anything which is somewhere close to those numbers down here, even if we allow many players. We didn't find anything. Perhaps we are stupid, too stupid, but we have no idea how you could make use of more players to get to these factors. And we think that our analysis that we have to get these bounds are too rough. I think we can drastically improve, it could be possible to drastically improve these bounds. We just didn't do it yet, and probably someone else should do it, but you would conjecture that you can decrease these bounds by a lot. There's a lot of room for improvement here. So what it tells us is that this concept of approximate equilibria actually increases the set of games, the classes of games where we have equilibria compared to the pure version without approximation. And it might actually extend that class in such a way that it's the alpha, the approximation factor, is realistically close to 1. Okay. There's another thing that I want to mention, which is not something like work that we already did, but some idea that popped up during our discussion. And this is some sort of trade-off between what I call incentive compatibility and optimality on the other hand. So incentive compatibility means that, well, something which is close to an equilibrium, something which is, well, people are happy to play that. Yeah? I mean, that an equilibrium, you could argue that players are happy in equilibrium in the sense that they are satisfied with what they get because they do not have any alternative that they could choose from. Okay, so this is the general idea. We know that in a natural equilibrium, the outcome might be worse compared to some objective function, worse than an optimal solution. We have this example here with this traffic routing, where we already saw that if you look in equilibrium, they do a zigzag path, both of them, it's much worse in terms of, let's say, average travel time compared to the optimal solution, which would be one on the upper, one on the lower path. There has been a lot of studies out there which tries to quantify how inefficient these equilibria are in terms of global objective functions, like here, for example, this average travel time. In some way, you could say a Nash equilibrium is some sort of an approximation, let's say a better approximation of the optimal solution. This value of better has already been studied very, very well. On the other hand, if you look at the optimal solution, so here both taking upper and lower path, in some sense, you could argue that an optimal solution always is an approximate equilibrium, possibly for a very large value of alpha. if you make alpha large enough, everything is in equilibrium, in particular the optimal solution. In some sense, you could say that this alpha quantifies how happy are players in some solution. And the question that we want to raise, or that I want to discuss, is what is actually in between? So are there states in between where we can say, OK, we have an, let's say, alpha prime approximate equilibrium, which is a better prime approximation of the optimal solution, where we have this trade-off between, well, this alpha and this beta. Is there something in between? And even more, what about computation? Can we compute such a solution, which is, on the one hand, close to an equilibrium, on the other hand, close to an optimal solution? This is, I find, a very interesting question, and you could ask, why do you want to compute such a thing? And, well, one justification is that assume you have a system where you can propose the solution, a state, to the users, but the users have to accept that solution. One example would be you have a navigational system and that tells people where to drive. It wants to tell people where to drive such that the overall traffic is somehow better. But on the other hand, of course, people should follow that advice, and they would only follow that advice if it makes the travel time not too bad. And in such a situation, you want to compute something like that. You want to compute something which is close to an equilibrium, so players cannot improve too much by changing to something else. And on the other hand, you want to compute something which is better than nothing, better than what we have out there on the streets right now. So this is, I think, a very interesting topic, and that is definitely open for future research. Okay, with that, I want to conclude with some remarks. I think that in the world that we live now in, which is more and more interconnected, so we can communicate all the time, we have sensors everywhere, we can have a lot more decisions that we can make than we probably did 50 years ago. Need more and more algorithms need more and more to deal with strategic behavior. Either they have it as an input, or they have to deal with people making these decisions. So I think it's more and more important to incorporate these aspects into our algorithms. To sum up, we discussed here some equilibrium concept. We basically focused on computational issues and tractability. And I hope that I convinced you somehow that approximate equilibria under certain circumstances might be a nice solution concept which has good computational properties. I think that research in that area just has started. I mean, you see in our results there's a lot of room for improvement, and the most obvious open questions is following to get a lot better bounds that we already have. We know that in some cases you can get better bounds. In other cases, it's not clear whether you get better lower or better upper bounds. And one should extend this concept to more classes or bigger classes of games to see if this concept of an approximate equilibrium can be applied somewhere else. Okay, with that, I want to thank you for your attention.